Hello everyone. Welcome back to another year of Spooky Saturdays. Every year, if you don't know, I read some short, scary stories from Reddit to help you fall asleep. They are creepy stories, spooky stories, but they're not so terrifying that you can't fall asleep. Recently, a few videos ago, I did another reading video where I read an Edgar Allan Poe short story and his famous poem, The Raven, and that one is an ambient video with a soft fireplace and a little thunderstorm in the background. So if you don't want to be distracted by my face and lights and all that, I recommend watching that video, as I think it's pretty relaxing. Also, saying before I start that if you're wondering why I have a scar on my face, my cat was playing in the bed with me. In fact, actually, I had my tablet that I'm going to read the stories on, and light was reflecting off of it, bouncing on the wall, so I was like going, I was messing around with him, and I kind of, I shone it like on the wall behind me, and he was like jumping around, and he stepped all over my face and scratched my face. And when that happened, I was like, I was gonna film today. Great. I also had to go out. I had a doctor's appointment, so everyone got to see my lovely cat's car. Okay, thank you, Pippin. Okay, so I have 4 short stories today, and like always, I'll put the links to the original stories, to the original authors, in the description. So if you really like it, you can go give them an upvote and tell them this was a good story. You can jump on the timeline, specific story, and if you've missed the previous years of the short scary stories, then I'll also link to those and you can see everything. And they're all in a little playlist that I make called like Spooky ASMR. And that has all my Spooky Saturday videos from previous years where I either heard stories or I play a horror game or like last week's haunted house tour. Okay. That's it for my boring little intro. I'm gonna start with the shortest of all the stories. It's called Tonight I Learned the Importance of Balance in an Ecosystem. I used to think my mother was insane, the way she planted flowers wherever she wanted instead of neatly in beds, the way she hung dried herbs in the kitchen. The thing that probably got to me the most was her radical acceptance of everything. Oh, leave the wasp nest be, they eat the caterpillars. Why would I bother the spiders in the bathroom? Do you see any other bugs? Oh, leave Mr. Benson, his bark is worse than his bite if you don't cross him. I tried to understand my mom, but it was hard. She talked about balance and ecosystems, but my friends didn't have cobwebs in their bathrooms. Worry about getting stung or chart a wide berth around Mr. Benson. Still, I tried. I left the wasps and spiders alone. I brought over the pies to Mr. Benson that my mom baked for him. Then, one night, I walked home from my friends. It wasn't far, but there was a stretch of dark woods along the way that made the hair on my neck rise. Tonight was no different. The feeling of being watched was intense. I knew Mom was waiting for me on the porch, but her house was still out of sight. Ahead of me, the bushes rustled. I froze. I was so focused on the woods ahead of me that I nearly jumped out of my skin when a guttural moan sounded behind me. I whipped around and time slowed as my brain tried to compute what staggered out of the woods. I think it was supposed to be a deer standing on its hind legs. The creature's head snapped toward me. I tried to run, tripped, and fell. Hyperventilating, I curled into a ball. Then I heard the bushes behind me rustle again. I felt something large burst out of the trees and fly over me, pinning the creature to the ground with a vicious growl. The creature was hairy, massive, and from the sounds that the deer creature was making, very hungry. I crawled backward away from them, still unable to stand. The hairy creature stood on its hind legs like the deer and turned to me. This creature, however, began to change as it approached. By the time it reached me, it had shrunk down to normal person size and taken the shape of Mr. Benson. He scanned the forest and then offered me a hand up, saying only, "It's late. You should head home." I held it together pretty well until I saw my mom waiting on the porch. Then the sobs ripped through me as I threw myself into her arms. I gave her a halting account of my ordeal and finished gravely, "Mom, I think Mr. Benson is some kind of monster." She smiled. "Of course he is, sweetheart. You knew?" "Well, yes. Do you see any other monsters around here?" I used to think my mom was insane. Now I know she's a genius. I liked that one because I thought it was very sweet and kind of wholesome. So, okay. I'm gonna move on to the next spooky story. This story is called Personality Test That Will Show You the Real You. It was probably 6:30 o'clock on a Tuesday. I unlaced my black Converse sneakers and put them down in the corner of my room before throwing myself into the center of the bed. I looked over to the desk beside me, took the laptop that typically sits there, and opened it. I decided it would be the best choice to scroll on the internet while I thought about what I wanted to do. I scrolled and scrolled. I ate some of the spoiled chips I left in my room months before tonight. Soon, however, my friend sent me an email. I groaned as I clicked on the email and read it to myself slowly, still munching on the not-so-good chips I had been eating before this. "Hey, pal, it's your buddy from work, Rob. I just took this super cool personality test a few hours ago and thought you might like it. Send me what you get. See you tomorrow at work." I rolled my eyes as I read the email. At the same time, I thought, hey, I had just been looking for something to do, right? What I had been looking for just placed itself neatly in my lap. A lame time killer. I sighed and put the chips aside as I clicked on the glowing blue link Rob had sent me. It took me to some lame quiz website with letters on the screen that read, "This personality test knows you better than you. Take the 15-question quiz now." How cheesy. I clicked continue. This test was as dumb as I thought it was. The first question was as simple as it gets. "Out of these colors, what do you like best?" There was red, green, purple, blue, and pink. I chose blue and clicked the next question button. "Out of these numbers, what do you like best?" I clicked 4, then continued. "Out of these statements, which of them is true to you?" I like to be around my friends. I mostly spend time alone. I like to live with friends and family. I live by myself. I questioned the second set of choices. I clicked the first choice and moved on. I would know if I was being watched. I chuckled when I saw the words show up on my screen. If Rob did know anything about me, he knew I loved creepy gag tests. I clicked yes and continued. I enjoy to meet new people. Not really. I prefer to be alone or with close friends. I picked no and moved on. I always make sure to lock doors and windows. Doors? Sure. Windows? Not so much. I still picked yes and moved to the next questions. I am alone right now. Of course I am. Unless a cat counts. I picked yes. How far is your nearest hospital? I'd moved to this house not that long ago. Maybe it has been a year by now. Regardless, I had no idea. It wasn't within 15 minutes of me, so I picked 20 miles. Somebody would know if I went missing. Most likely, I picked yes. I am a likable person. Well, I'd like to think so. I picked yes. My neighbors would look for me if I went missing. My only neighbor was some crazy old cat lady. She hates me. Well, she hates everyone. I picked no. I am aware of my surroundings. I mean, I am blasting music so loud I can't even hear myself think. I picked no. You should close your window. I looked up to the open window next to my bed. How did this know about my window? I walked over and stuck my head out the window. The city still marched on below me, and the hot spring breeze kept blowing. No creeps spying on me. I closed the window and locked it. A new prompt was already on my screen when I returned. I am prepared to fight for my life if I had to. I paused for a second. I took the moment to text my mom and lock the door to my room. I then clicked yes. Did you have fun? Nope. This test is a bit creepy, even for me. I still clicked yes. Thank you for submitting your test. Please wait. I watched the website load for a while. Great. I broke the stupid thing. I looked down at my phone and texted my coworker about his broken test when I heard a small ping from my laptop. Test results are in. Click here to view them. I expected to see some kind of lame write-up, but what I saw chilled me to my very bone. It was a picture of me answering question 7 from my bedroom window. Alright, I thought that was a fun. Alright, our next story is called Strawberry Licorice. When I was a kid, most of my pocket money was spent on candy from ice cream sodas. It was an independent store in my small town, specializing in pretty much everything that caused cavities. The walls were filled with all kinds of candies, chocolates, and sodas. There was a small cabinet with a selection of homemade candy. There was even a bar where you could enjoy a freshly made milkshake, cone, or coffee. The owner was an old man called Mr. Bramley, who had the demeanor of a pleasant older relative. He ran the store all by himself. I never considered it when I was young, but I had no idea how he managed it with no help. You could tell it was a big passion for him, though. He was always a warm and cheerful man. I'd visit every Saturday and Sunday with my friend Jackson. I rarely had any more than a buck, but this is going back some years, and I got a lot more those days. One day, as I was choosing a selection of tooth-rotting treats, I saw Jackson stuff some jawbreakers into his socks. "Jackson, that's stealing," I whispered. "You'll get in trouble." leave you tattletale, Dylan, he grinned. It made me so anxious that I went to pay for my candy. My hands were shaking like I'd done something bad. Everything okay, Dylan? Asked Mr. Bramley with a smile. I nodded with a huge fake grin as I took the pinstripe paper bag from the counter. Yes, Mr. Bramley. Have a nice day. When we left, I had to compose myself outside. Don't be a baby, said Jackson, sucking on a jawbreaker like he'd done nothing wrong. The next time we visited, I spoke to Jackson before we went in. Please, don't steal again. I'll get you something. He pulled out $5 from his pocket. My jaw dropped. I've got money, he laughed. Why pay if I don't have to? Because it's bad. If Mr. Bramley calls the police... Mr. Bramley is a blind old fool, Dylan. He doesn't notice anything. When we went in, I made a point of standing away from Jackson. I chose my candies and paid at the counter. Nothing for you today, Jackson? Asked Mr. Bramley, looking over his glasses. Jackson stuttered a little. Oh, no thank you, Mr. Bramley. I don't have any money. You can't leave with nothing, said Mr. Bramley. He took a pack of bazooka bubble gum from the counter and handed it to Jackson. Gee, thanks, Mr. Bramley, said Jackson, accepting the kind offer. I couldn't believe it. You have money, Jackson, I said when we got outside. Lots of money. So? They didn't have to give me anything, Dylan. I'm not going to turn down free gum. He proceeded to pull out more candy from his socks and laughed. This isn't right, I said, feeling bad about everything. You're such a dork, he said, getting on his bike and riding off. See ya, Dorcas. It was a massive weight for an 8-year-old to carry. I don't want to be a tattletale. Snitches get stitches and all that. But I also knew it was very wrong, and I didn't like him doing it. The moral dilemma kept me awake at night. One Sunday I went to Ice Cream Sodas without Jackson. I began my usual ritual of taking forever to choose from the various bright wrappers. Come have a milkshake, Dylan, said Mr. Bramley. What's your favorite flavor? I don't have enough money, Mr. Bramley, I said. Milkshakes were $1.50, and I only had my usual dollar. It's on the house, young man, he smiled. So what'll it be? I grinned and climbed onto one of the bar stools. Chew his, thanks. Chocolate, please. I watched him blend the ice cream and milk, topping the glass with cream and chocolate chips. You're a good kid, Dylan, said Mr. Bramley as I enjoyed the shake. I probably had chocolate all over my mouth, but didn't care as I grinned. No Jackson today, I see. My grin faded a bit as I looked down. No, I think he's doing something with his folks. I know what he's been up to, he said. My stomach churned. I dropped the spoon and rambled without stopping for breath. I'm sorry, Mr. Bramley. I know it's a bad thing. I tried to stop him, but he wouldn't listen. I said the police would be mad, and if his folks ever found out... Shush, he said, patting my shoulder. Calm down, son. I'm not mad at you. I started to hyperventilate and cry. He handed me a napkin. Stop that now, you hear me? I know you're not one and the same. I nodded as I wiped my face, feeling such relief. I feel bad because you're a nice man. He smiled and waved a hand. I'm all right, I suppose. I have my moments like everyone else. Tell you what I'm gonna do. I'll give Jackson one more chance to be good and honest. If he's not, then I'll have to take the matter further. Does that sound fair? Will I get in trouble too? I asked. Not at all. You're not his accomplice, are you? I quickly shook my head. No, Mr. Bramley. I promise. He chuckled. I believe you, young man. I'm quite good at spotting the bad ones. You're a good egg. With that, he gave a wink. Now come on, finish that chocolate shake. The following weekend, Jackson and I rode our bikes to the store. On the way, I tried to talk him out of doing anything bad. I think Mr. Bramley might know you're scheme things. What makes you say that? He asked. No reason, I shrugged. Just, he's not stupid. He's old and blind as a bat, Dylan. He has no idea. What's it to you, anyway? I just don't want you to get in trouble, I said. Nerd, he yelled, putting the pedals down and speeding ahead. You can't say I didn't warn him, and that's what I told myself. I parked my bike and entered ice cream sodas, enjoying that sweet smell that hit you. Good morning, Dylan, said Mr. Bramley from behind the counter. He had a knowing smile on his face. Morning, Mr. Bramley, I said, joining Jackson. When Mr. Bramley turned, Jackson took some pixie sticks and atomic fireballs, shoving them in his socks again. He didn't stop there, though. He took some M&Ms and Pez and put them in his pockets. Please don't, Jackson, I whispered. He nudged me out of the way and picked up a comic from the newspaper rack. I took my selection to the counter, and Mr. Bramley winked at me. Just this today, boss? He asked, looking over at Jackson, who just nodded. Can't tempt you to some fireballs? Or M&Ms? Jackson looked a little sheepish as he put the comic back. No cash again, Mr. Bramley. Oh, well, that's not fair now, is it? Said Mr. Bramley, leaning on the counter. I'm sure you do lots of chores and help out your folks, right? You should be rewarded with a little pocket change. They cut me off, said Jackson. I'm not as lucky as Dylan. That made me angry. Well, I can't see you go without, said Mr. Bramley. He opened the cabinet and took out a tub. Using tongs, he pulled out a bunch of strawberry licorice laces. I made these myself, and they're absolutely delicious, if I may say so. He put them in a paper bag and held them out, looking at Jackson. Are you sure? Asked Jackson, approaching the counter. Mr. Bramley nodded. If you really have no means to buy anything, then I insist. Jackson took the bag and his face lit up. They smell amazing. Mr. Bramley had a glint in his eye. They're one of my finest creations. Now, is that all today, boys? I was so hopeful that Jackson would have a change of heart, pull out the candy he'd stolen, and confessed everything. But he looked Mr. Bramley right in the eye and nodded with a smile. Thanks, Mr. Bramley. He left the store with the strawberry laces. I looked up at the counter feeling embarrassed. He just shrugged with a smile. Well, I gave him a chance, didn't I? I nodded. I'm sorry. Don't be silly, he said, handing me some small change. You've done nothing wrong. Are you going to call the police? I asked, the thought making me so nervous for Jackson. Don't you worry about that, Dylan. Whatever happens, you won't be involved, I promise. He grabbed an extra bar of Hershey's and popped it inside my bag of treats. I nodded a slight smile. Thank you, Mr. Bramley. When I left the store, Jackson had already left without me. I biked around looking for him for a while before I went back home. My mom came to my room later in the day to say she'd just gotten off the phone with Jackson's mom. He didn't come home. Do you know where he might be? I gulped and shook my head. He left the candy store without me. I don't know where he went. I kept thinking about how the police had probably arrested him and took him in for questioning. My little heart beat so hard. Days went by, and no one had heard from Jackson. The police came to my house after school, and I almost had a heart attack when my mom said they wanted to talk to me. In a panic, I told them everything, how Jackson had been stealing from the store, and Mr. Bramley knew about it. I thought he called you guys, and you arrested him, I cried. The officers looked at each other and said they would talk to Mr. Bramley about it. In the meantime, there were search parties out looking for Jackson. They found him late that evening, in the woods by town. All I was told at the time was, Jackson had died. I was too young to hear the exact details, which I learned about myself later in life. There was a clump of strawberry licorice laces hanging out of his mouth. The ends were deep inside his chest, having choked him to death. There were no visible signs of them being physically forced from the outside. It appeared they'd been either willingly swallowed or pulled from inside. Mr. Bramley was questioned due to my confession and being one of the last people to see Jackson alive. When asked about the stealing, he said he'd planned to call Jackson's parents and tell them about it. That obviously wasn't necessary after the tragic news. The case was later deemed unsolvable. It's funny, the way you remember some things from childhood, and how certain other things trigger other memories. It wasn't until I learned the details of Jackson's death, and then I remembered something else from that day in the store. It made my blood run cold. When Mr. Bramley kindly gave me that extra bar of Hershey's, he'd said something else, too. "This is just for you, Dylan. The strawberry licorice is just for Jackson. You understand?" Alright. So, I only have one more spooky story to read you. It's another long one. So settle in. And then you can feel free to drift off to sleep if you can. Alright, this last story is called "My Childhood Town Isn't on Any Map." Saunter. A word used to describe the profound feeling of realizing every stranger around you has a life as complex and important as your own. It's also the name of the town I grew up in. Saunter lies on the eastern coast of the UK, on the north side of England. If you reach Scotland, you've gone too far, but if you're in Scarborough, you've not gone far enough. It sits somewhere between there, though I don't think anyone could be more specific. You see, you can't find it on any map, printed or digital, new or old, color-coded or satellite imagery. There is no sign of this town existing at all. If you pay enough attention online, you'll find the odd few people mentioning the place, like this that you're reading right now. Like a whisper passing by in a busy place, you only know it's there if you're looking for it. Yet, to the vast majority of the world, Saunter is just a word. I was born there and raised within its confines. I moved away at 15, about 10 years ago. It was a peaceful seaside village, the type where everyone knows each other, the type where when someone hosts a get-together, all residents are invited. It was a close-knit community. I still remember it with mostly fond memories. The waves lapping onto the sand all through the night, the cobbled streets scorching your bare feet as you walk back from the beach on a summer's day, the dark woods that overlook the town from High Hill. High Hill is what we called the hill that stood next to Saunter. It blocked any chance of a view to other towns or cities. We resided in a valley, at the edge of the sea, and whilst we liked it there, it felt very secluded. The town had a few small businesses. My favorite was Uncle Pete's Pizza. Everyone called him Uncle Pete, although he wasn't actually anybody's uncle. But his pizza place was perfectly between our home and my mom's pub. Every Friday, she'd pick up a pizza on the way home. Absolutely no exceptions. Me and my older brother Jacob were always excited for this. Much of the town has been there for generations, the population naturally getting smaller as more and more of it became family. But a few people would move there every now and then. All of them found the town in the same way, a leaflet coming through the letterbox while searching for somewhere to move to. Every single time, the same story. They were driven here by house moving service. I guess with no directions or map, it would be difficult to make your own way here. They were lovely, they really helped us, they would always say. Nobody ever really seemed to question it much. I mean, it's not like we were trapped. We could leave whenever we wanted. Make no mistake, Sander was no prison. It didn't even feel like one. It's just difficult to find. And leaving just felt icky. Like you shouldn't do it. As the internet became mainstream, it became more and more obvious to people that the town was hard to find. Suddenly people had friends from outside of Sander, but they could never visit because they could never seem to find their way in. GPS signals weak, and opening any app on your phone that tracked your location wouldn't pinpoint you. One truly odd thing about Sander was the appliances. All of them had the same logo on somewhere, the letter V in a circle. Since leaving, I've tried to research this company, but to no avail. The moving company that people arrived in also had this logo on their vans. The town had its issues, none more known than the Scream Singers. At night, if you listened hard enough, you could hear them. A chilling, soft sound. It was almost like a distant scream, yet more melodic. Something enchanting, yet fills you with dread. Nobody ever saw them, but someone in the town would go missing every now and then, maybe once or twice a year. Some lived alone, hadn't been seen in a few days before anyone realized. Some were cuddled up to their partner in bed, only for their partner to wake up with them no longer in their arms. The only thing they had in common is that there was never any entry or sign of struggle. My entire life I've known the echoes over the valley to mean trouble, but my mother used to tell me stories of when the townsfolk thought they meant hope, a simpler time. It's difficult to pinpoint exactly when people made the connection between the disappearances and the whistles of the night. But they would always start a few weeks before a disappearance and stop the night after someone had gone missing. This had always intrigued me, but not as much as it did my brother. Jacob found it fascinating, perhaps because he had never had someone close to him taken and didn't understand the pain. To him, it was just a mystery wrapped in questions. Some believe the Scream Singers to be the ones taking these people. Some believe their calls to be a warning that something darker is coming. Whatever people believe their intentions to be, everyone knew that their somber singing over Sander was only bad news. My fond memories of the town became clouded when the trauma of my final few days there enters my mind again. Years of therapy have helped me cope, but I feel talking about it publicly is the final thing that may bring me peace. As far as I know, I am the only person to have seen a Scream Singer. Or at least, the only living person. It was the summer solstice, the longest day of the year, the 21st of June. Sander's always held a small festival on this day. It dated back almost a century at the time, before the 97th consecutive solstice celebration. The festival took place not during those long sunlight hours, but as the sun began to set, and the longest day ceased, at around 9:30 p.m. But the town of Sander felt more melancholy than usual, especially for the festivities that were going on. The Scream Singers had started their wails again about 3 weeks prior, getting louder and louder each passing night. Sure enough, about an hour after the festival began, you could faintly hear the noises again, piercing through the sweeter melodies of the festival and the chatter of the crowds. People tried to ignore it and continue the celebrations, but every time the wind blew in just a particular way to make the noises more prominent, you could see the look on everyone's faces, the unspoken, silent fear washing through the crowds like a wave. My mom's pub, really our family pub, was right at the festival, As such, the doors were wide open and people kept coming in and out. It was always one of the busiest nights of the year. Me and Jacob were sat drinking red wine. He was 17 and had a proper glass, but I still had half a lemonade in mine. It was the only night of the year I was allowed to drink alcohol. The festival was still going strong when Jacob had the idea to go a little out of town and get a better listen to the scream singers. I was hesitant, but I was always up for an adventure, so half reluctantly, I agreed. We got a few streets away before the howling became louder than the music. We were stood in the perfect mix of unknown to one side and enjoyment to the other. We should not have kept going, but we did. We reached the final building before the cobbled streets turned to grass and mud, and didn't stop there. Without saying a word to each other, it was like we knew what we wanted to do. We wanted to be the first people to have seen the scream singers, the first to understand them. We didn't know that only one of us would catch a glimpse. High Hill was steep, but not too steep. You didn't need your hands to climb it, it just took a lot of energy. Every now and then we looked back at Sonder. You would almost think it was a ghost town from how dark it looked, if not for the bright festival right in the center. The only clue of any life, all packed together. The sounds of cheering, singing, and music echoed up the hill. All the while, the sounds of ghostly wails echoed down. A battle between good and evil, not seen but only heard. As we reached the dark woods, we looked at each other. It felt like we hadn't spoken in ages, so I broke that. We're really doing this? Jacob nodded. I knew he would. I just needed to say something. Hearing nothing but ghastly screeches was driving me insane. We wandered around in there for what seemed like forever, though it was closer to maybe 5 minutes. Every slight crunch made me flinch and turn around. There was never anything there. The haunting screams, which were all around us. We reached a clearing, and the sounds of the scream singers seemed louder than ever. In the center of the clearing was a rock, about as tall as me and a little wider. Jacob held me, as he could clearly tell I was scared. It's all right, it's just sounds. There's nothing to be afraid of. Maybe we should head back. His words didn't comfort me. They only told me one thing. He couldn't see what I could see. Stood on the rock is something I will never get out of my mind. A tall, gray figure, about twice as tall as any human I'd ever seen. It had two arms, but only one hand. The hand it had looked what I can only describe as twisted. Its fingers weaved together in a way that didn't make sense, and certainly wasn't natural. The shape of it was overall humanoid, but the proportions were all wrong. It had no eyes, at least not at first. I was terrified looking at this thing, but the moment my heart truly dropped was when eyes appeared. They slowly came out of its skin. There was no evidence that this creature should even have eyes. There were no holes for them. But as its face opened in a mesmerizingly disturbing way, I saw two eyes slowly come forward. The face closed again, with the eyes looking right at us. There were only two eyes. I counted them. 1, 2. Its face opened up again as it let out a horrific scream. I ran faster than I have ever before in my life, only occasionally looking behind me to make sure Jacob was running with me. He was, but he wasn't running from the scream singer. He was only running to catch up with me. He had no idea why I was so scared at that moment. We ran all the way down High Hill, nearly tripping over. Running down a steep hill is difficult at the best of times. As we got out back onto the cobbled streets, I turned around and looked up at the woods. No sign of anything chasing us, but the screams were still so loud, even down here. By this point, Jacob had caught up and was right beside me. He kept asking why I was running, and I was too shocked to answer him yet. We ran another street, and he reached out to hold me. I stopped running and let him hug me. He told me that whatever I saw was going to be okay, and that we were safe. I closed my eyes with tears streaming down my face. I opened my mouth and began to explain what I saw, getting words out between choking on my tears. It was this gray thing on the rock. You could see the rock, right? Well, on top. I realized the howling had stopped. I opened my eyes. Jacob wasn't there. I was standing in the middle of the street with my arms out, hugging nobody. I looked to my right and could see the festival. I felt empty and confused. I walked through the crowd, tears still streaming down my face. I found my mother at the bar and she asked me where I had been, if I knew where Jacob was. I told her everything and she closed up for the night. We both knew that the Scream Singers had claimed their next victim. She wasn't angry at me for going to the woods. She held me tight, and neither of us spoke a word. We just wept and wept until we were too tired and empty to weep anymore. The next day was Friday. I got out of bed in the morning after absolutely no sleep. My mom was downstairs packing boxes. She told me we were leaving that same day. Within an hour, we were in her car, driving away from home. We passed Uncle Pete's Pizza. I realized this was the first Friday in my life that we weren't eating from there. As we drove further away from the sea, and I saw outside that small town for the first time, I already knew that leaving our life behind would not fix anything. Sonder is still out there. I hope somebody can find it. I think that was a really well-written story. I really enjoyed it.